Good morning students. Today I would like to teach you 11th lesson in your 7th class, New Kings and Kingdom. So actually history was divided into three parts: ancient history, medieval history and modern history. Ancient history started from BC to 8th century and medieval history started from 8th century AD to 18th century AD, and modern history started from 18th century to 1947. So ancient history started from BC, from earliest man, before the birth of Christ. History was started from the earliest people. So 6th class already you studied about the earliest people to after the birth of Jesus Christ, AD, 8th century AD. So we can call AD. AD means not after the death of Jesus Christ. We call Anno Domini. It's an abbreviation, Anno Domini. So for our convenience, we changed this AD to CE, Common Era. So anyway, ancient history started from earliest man to 8th century AD. Next, medieval history started from 8th century AD to 18th century AD. At the same time, modern history started from 18th century AD to up to got the independence in 1947. So 6th class explains about the ancient history. 7th class you are going to learn about the medieval history, and you will be learning in your 8th class about the modern history. So 8th to 18th century, there were number of kingdoms flourished between 8th century to 18th century. Let's see what were the kingdoms flourished between 8th century to 18th century. Chalukyas, Rashtrakutas, Pratiharas, Palas, Chahmanas, Chohans, Cholas, Pallavas, Kakatiyas, Vijayanagaras, Mughals, and Muslim rulers like Mughals, Muhammad Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori. Once again, Chalukyas, Rashtrakutas, Pratiharas, Palas, Chahmanas or Chauhans, Cholas, Pallavas, Kakatiyas, Vijayanagara kings, Mughals, Muhammad Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori. Emergence of new dynasties or emergence of new kingdoms between the 8th century. So by the 7th century, ending of 7th century and starting of 8th century, there were big landlords. Landlords means those who have more acres of land and they were control that particular area. So, and or warrior chiefs. Warrior chiefs means those who are familiar and skilled persons in the martial arts. In different regions of the subcontinent, existing kings often acknowledged them as their subordinates or samantas. So for their convenience, kings appointed some subordinates or samantas. They were expected to bring the gifts for their kings or overlord. Samantas wanted the compliments and gifts from their kings. So they done a lot of hard work and they made a friendship with the king. So be present at their courts and provide them with military support as Samantas gained the power or wealth. And they declared themselves to be Maha Samantas or Maha Mandaleshwara and so on. So those who were close to the king, they declared themselves as a Maha Samantas or Maha Mandaleshwara. Sometimes they assisted their independence from their overlords. So they conquered the king and they occupied the kingdom also, and they declared themselves as a kings. So anyway, subordinates or samantas, they made a friendship with the kings. After that, they declared themselves as a Maha Samantas or Maha Mandaleshwaras. After that, they occupied the kingdom, then they declared as a kings. Next one, Rashtrakutas. So Rashtrakutas were the familiar kings in the Karnataka. Rashtrakutas founder Dantidurga. Dantidurga was the founder of Rashtrakuta dynasty. So who was the founder of Rashtrakuta dynasty? Tanti Durga was the founder of Rashtrakuta dynasty. They were the subordinates to the Chalukyas of Karnataka. They were the subordinates or Samantas to the Chalukyas of Karnataka. In the mid-8th century, Tanti Durga, a Rashtrakuta chief, overthrew his Chalukyan overlord and performed a ritual called against the king. Tanti Durga performed a ritual or yajna called Hiranyagarbha to rebirth as a Kshatriya. So anyway, kings wanted to show their power and greatness to the other king. They performed some yajnas and yagas. For example, Lord Sri Rama performed Ashwamedha Yaga. In the same way, in the medieval history, Chalukyas, against the Chalukyas, Tanti Durga performed a ritual called Hiranyagarbha. Why he performed Hiranyagarbha? So after the death of a king, after the death of his, then he wanted to rebirth as a Kshatriya. So to rebirth as a Kshatriya, kings performed a ritual called Hiranyagarbha. Next, the society was totally, society or the people, divided into four categories depending on their activity: Kshatriyas, Brahmins, Vaishyas and Sudra. Kshatriyas, so those who ruled the kingdom and those who know the warfare methods or martial arts, they were called the Kshatriya. Brahmins, those who done the yajnas and yagas and those who done the performance in the temple, we call that people Brahmins. Vaishyas, so those who done the business activities in the society, they were called the Vaishya. And Sudras were the least category in the society, so they served to the people and they became very poor people and they lived outskirts of the kingdom, far away from the kingdom. They became very poor person and behaved like slavers or servants to the other people in the society. Anyway, society was divided into four categories: Kshatriyas, Brahmins, Vaishyas and Sudra. So who was the least category in the society? Sudras. And who got the majority in the society? Brahmins and Kshatriyas. So Brahmin kings, not only Kshatriya kings, even Brahmins also learned the martial all and they became also kings. For example, Kadamba, Mayura Sharma, Gujara Pratihara, King Harichandra were the famous Brahmins who gave up their traditional profession and took the arms, successfully established the kingdoms in Karnataka and Rajasthan respectively. Not only they performed the yajnas and yaga, they left their yajnas and yaga and they participated in the warfare. So they became the kings. So even Brahmins also ruled the kingdom like a Kshatriya. Example, Kadamba, Mayura Sharma, Gujara Pratihara, King Harichandra. So let's see in the next slide. So Harichandra, let's see here, Kadamba, Mayura Sharma and Gujara Pratihara. So basically they were the Brahmins family, but they performed the martial arts in the warfare. They ruled the kingdom. Next, Prasasti and land grants. Prasastis means inscriptions. Inscriptions, actually prasastis or inscriptions started by Ashoka. So Ashoka laid 84,000 inscriptions. What was there on the prasasti? Achievements and failures of a king. Mostly achievements printed on the prasastis. So the invocation part of an inscription is called prasasti. Prasasti contains the details about the ruling families, such as days, procedures and the period to which they belonged to. And they also contain exaggerated accounts of rulers and their achievements, but they tell us how rulers wanted to depict themselves as, for example, valiant, victorious, various, And these were composed and learned by the Brahmins who occasionally helped in the administration. So what was there on the prashasti? Prashasti contains the details of a particular king, their period, their achievement, victories. Everything is printed on the prashasti. Who printed? I mean, who wrote on the prashasti and who explains about the prashasti? Actually, Brahmins wrote on the prashasti, and Brahmins performed the yagnas and yaga. For done the yagnas and yagas, so kings gave some gifts to the Brahmins in the form of lands. So let's see. Kings gave the gifts to the Brahmins in the form of lands. So now we have paper documents about the land. But in the olden days, there was no document, nothing. So this is the inscription. First, let's see the inscription. This is the inscription explains about the greatness of kings and rulers in those times. So let's see one of the example of inscription. The achievements of Nagabatta. Actually, Nagabatta was a Gurjara Pratihara king. So we found one inscription in Gwalior in Madhya Pradesh. So what was there on the inscription? Let's see. Many rulers describe their achievements, victories in their prashastis. One prashasti written in Sanskrit language and found in Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh. It describes the exploits of Nagabatta, a Pratihara king, as follows. So this was the inscription found in Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh. It explained about the Nagabatta. Who was Nagabatta? Nagabatta was a Gurjara Pratihara king. What was there about the Nagabatta on the inscription? His achievements when he was a prince, after became the king. Let's see first one. The kings of Andhra, Saindava. Saindava means Sindh. Vidarbha. Vidarbha in Maharashtra. Kalinga. You know, Kalinga was famous at the time of Ashoka also. Kalinga. Where is Kalinga? Kalinga is in Odisha. Fell before him even as a prince. When he was a prince, he occupied these all the kingdoms. Andhra, Saindava, Vidarbha and Kalinga. Next, he won a war over Chakrayudha. So he occupied the Kanuj also, because Kanuj was famous in medieval period. So Kanuj was also occupied by Nagabatta. So who was the ruler of Kanuj in those times? Chakrayudha. So Chakrayudha was failed in the hands of Nagabatta. Next, he defeated the king of Vanga. So he conquered the Vanga. Vanga belongs to Bengal. Anartha, Gujarat. Malwa, Madhya Pradesh. Kirata, forest people. Turushka, Turuks. Vasta, Machha. Both kingdoms are in North India. So he occupied these all the places. He got so many victories. These victories are achievements printed on the prashasti. So where we find about Nagabatta inscription? We found in Gwalior in Madhya Pradesh. In which language? It was in Sanskrit language. Next, I told you already, copper plates. Now we have land documents. Land document papers. So we have papers. Documents are in the form of paper. But olden days there was no paper. So documents, land documents are printed on the copper plates. So kings often rewarded. Kings gave the gifts to the Brahmins in the form of land. These land records on copper plates, which were given to those who received the land. So who received these copper plates? Brahmins received the copper plates from the kings. Why they received these copper plates? To print it on the prashastis, and they performed the yagnas and yagas. So it was explains about one copper plate. So let's see, it is the picture I have taken from the textbook. So what was there in the copper plate? So fruit bearing trees. What was there in the copper plate? It contains the fruit bearing trees, water, land, gardens, orchards, trees, wells, open spaces, patches, a village, ant hills, platform, canals, ditches, rivers, silt laden lands, tanks, granaries, fish ponds, beehives and deep lakes. So this all is there in the copper plate. So he can build a large rooms. I mean, those who receive the copper plate, he has right. He has a power to build the room. Upper stories made up of baked bricks. He can get a large and small wells dug. He can plant the trees and thorny bushes if necessary. He can get the canals construction for irrigation. He should ensure that water is not wasted and the embankment or built. But one condition, those who receive the copper plate, he has no right to the same copper plate to give to the others. So he can use that copper plate, I mean he can use that land. So after the death of that particular person, so he had to give that copper plate to their son or daughter. So there was no right to give the same copper plate to the other people. So next, in the medieval history, one famous poet, Kalhana wrote a famous book, Rajatarangini, very important. Kalhana was a famous poet in the medieval century. In the 12th century, a long Sanskrit poem containing the history of king who ruled over Kashmir and was composed by an author named Kalhana. He used a variety of sources including the inscription, document, eyewitness accounts and earlier histories to write his account, unlike the writers of present days, and he was often critical about the rulers and their policies. So Kalhana was a famous poet in the 12th century. He belongs to Kashmir. He wrote a famous book, Rajatarangini. Rajatarangini explains about the Kashmir rulers. So it was the Rajatarangini book, but now it is available in English language also. It was translated from Sanskrit language to English language. M.S. Train translated this Kalhana Rajatarangini from Sanskrit to English language. Let's see, warfare for wealth. So kings wanted to become more powerful and they wanted to develop their wealth. So they participated in the warfare. So there was a famous warfare, three party struggle. Three kingdoms were fought with each other to occupy one wealthiest kingdom. Three party struggle. For centuries, rulers belonging to Gujara, Pratihara, Rashtrakuta and Pala dynasties fought for control over the Kanauj. So Gujara, Pratihara king, Rashtrakutas and Palas, they fought for control over the Kanauj. As there were three parties in this long drawn conflict, historians often described it as the three party struggle. So there was a famous struggle between the Gujara, Pratihara, Rashtrakutas and Palas. These three people fought with each other to occupy the Kanauj. Why they wanted to occupy the Kanauj? Because Kanauj was near the Ganga Valley and it was totally developed area, agriculturally developed area, and the people were also able to pay the taxes to the king. So Gujara Pratihara king, Rashtrakuta king, Palas king, they wanted to occupy the Kanauj. It was called three party struggle. Students remember, very important, three party struggle. There was a struggle, a long struggle between Gujara Pratihara king, Rashtrakuta king and Pala kings. They were fought with each other to occupy the Kanauj. Why they fought with each other to occupy the Kanauj? Because they wanted to develop their wealth. Kanauj was near the Ganga Valley. Kanauj also developed, agriculturally developed area. The people were also able to pay the taxes to the kings. Next one, Afghanistan Muslims. So in the medieval century, Afghanistan people also invaded to India, especially Muslims. They wanted to introduce their religion in the other country and they wanted to loot at the wealth. They wanted to loot at the temples also in India. For these three things, for these three purposes, they came to India, especially Afghanistan Muslims. Let's see here. Arabs were the first Muslims who invaded India in the 719 AD. First Muslims invaded to India, Arabs invaded to India in the 719 AD. After that, in the 9th and 10th century, in the medieval history. Afghanistan Muslims Muhammad Ghori and Muhammad Ghazni were invaded to India. Afghanistan Muslims Muhammad Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori were invaded to India. Let's see, he was the Muhammad Ghazni. Muhammad Ghazni ruled from 997 AD to 1030 AD and expected control over the parts of Central Asia, Iran and northwestern part of the subcontinent. He raided the subcontinent almost every year. 17 years he invaded to India. At last he was succeeded. So he looted one temple in our India, Somnath temple. He looted one temple in India because wealth, economically, socially, all the centers of temple. So temples were the centers of wealth. So Muslims wanted to loot at the temple. Muhammad Ghazni wanted to loot at the Somnath temple at Gujarat. You know, Somnath temple is in Gujarat. Now, recently it was reconstructed in Gujarat. So Muhammad Ghazni time, Arabic poet Al-Biruni was an Arabic poet. He wrote a book about the Muhammad Ghazni and also Muhammad Ghori, why they invaded India, why they looted the temples. Everything is in one book. So Al-Biruni wrote a famous book, Kitab al-Hind. Al-Biruni wrote a book, Kitab al-Hind explains about the Muhammad Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori. So let's see, Muhammad Ghori defeated Chauhan ruler or Chahmana ruler Prithviraj Chauhan was a great patriotic man. He wanted to protect the India. He wanted to protect the India from the Afghanistan Muslim. So he fought with Muhammad Ghori at First Tharain War and Second Tharain War. In the First Tharain War in 1191 AD, Prithviraj Chauhan was succeeded in the First Tharain War, but in the Second Tharain War, Prithviraj Chauhan was failure in the hands of Muhammad Ghori. So First Tharain War, Prithviraj Chauhan was succeeded, but in the Second Tharain War, unfortunately, he was failure in the Second Tharain War. So First Tharain War 1191, Second Tharain War 1192. So the war was happened in the Tharain place, so it was called Tharain War. So Tharain War between Prithviraj Chauhan and Muhammad Ghori. Who was succeeded in the First Tharain War? Prithviraj Chauhan. Who was succeeded in the Second Tharain War? Muhammad Ghori. So after the Tharain War, Muhammad Ghori occupied Delhi, Lahore, Sindh. Okay, student, second part. So in the 11th lesson, second part, Chola Empire, about the Cholas. So I'll explain in the next class. Thank you very much.